And well, welcome everybody to our gathering with Ronne Rock. I love saying her name. And she's going to talk to us today about if there's ever a time when it's okay to lay down the pen, turn off the computer, rest a little bit from the things that we are so often busy doing. So welcome, Ronne. Thank you for being here today, joining us for the second time, I believe, teaching here on the block. So really grateful to have you here. And maybe we could just start off with defining terms a little bit. So when we talk about Sabbath and Sabbathing as a verb, what does that mean?
That is a great question. I know most of us, if we look and you look in good Merriam-Webster or the dictionary, it will talk about a lot of times the fact that it is a defined, especially for those of us in that are followers of Christ, that it is a time set aside to pause, to not do things. We talk about, for us, many of us, if we attend church on Sunday, Sunday becomes Sabbath. We know that in Jewish tradition, Sabbath starts on a Friday night and it goes to Saturday at sunset. So it's sunset to sunset. So the concept of Sabbath, or taking a time away from, taking rest, re-energizing. I think we have a tendency to create structure around it, that you are stepping away from, you are stopping doing something. What I personally love is if you look in Genesis, when the Lord created, and we could get into a whole thing, because it's one of my favorite things to do with kids is to talk about how intelligently the Lord created the heavens and earth. And if you look at the order in which he did it, God's so smart. He knew that atmosphere was going to be needed. He knew that water was going to be needed. And if you look even at that creative order, just how beautiful it is and how faith and science marry together. It's so cool. But it was amazing because if you look, we talk about the 7-day creation. Well, resting was actually a piece of the creative process for God. It was not, it was baked in to his creative process. And so we don't talk about it was the 6-day creation and then God took a nap. It is no, his resting, his stepping back, his looking at what had been done, thinking about what was to come. That was a piece of the creative process. Then when he is talking about the importance of rest and community, that is long before there were any big laws. The idea of rest came before sin. The idea of rest came before the idea of work was created. So it wasn't that Sabbath is, I work really, really hard and then I take a day off. Sabbath in scripture is actually a therefore. It is Sabbath is the thing that fuels us to be creative. Sabbath, that rest and that contemplation and that opportunity to just sit and be quiet, or sit and allow all of the creative beauty in which God reveals himself to, for us to be able to appreciate it, notice it, those things actually fuels our ability to then work in whatever our vocation is. So as writers, I think a lot of times, I know I'm so guilty of it, and that's what got me to really focus on the importance of safeguarding a soul and how do we build rest in, and how do we move from a place of rest, was because so often I would block time. It's like, oh, I'm a writer, I need to write. And I would block all of these times to write into my calendar, but I never would block, I need to just rest and contemplate and then allow what God is teaching me to fuel what I was going to put on the paper. It ended up being a, when I'm done, then I'll get to. as opposed to, now I'm going to start with rest. I'm going to start with an attitude of quiet, still contemplation, and then allow that to give birth to the words on the page or the words that are spoken or the art that is formed or whatever. So
I
love
that,
that it is, there, and there's so many ways to Sabbath and so many thoughts about everything that needs to be fueled from a place of rest.
I love that you said, and this is such a good thing to consider, is that, you know, it wasn't that God ran out of things to create and therefore he rested. I think that that's the way I've kind of looked at it too. It's like, oh, well, when you're done, that's just something you can do kind of leftover. Like, but that was an intentional piece. It was 1/7 of the week. It wasn't just all the work was done and therefore now that he has some time off, now he can rest. But that was always a part of the created order.
Yeah.
That was part of the work week necessary in this case of the creation. So I think that's such a mindset shift for us. Don't you think, as maybe as Americans especially, that we are we tack on rest as if it's like a bonus or an extra thing if you have the time to have it?
Yeah, we here, especially in the United States, I have the opportunity with my work, as I do a tremendous amount of global travel. And so I am hit square in the face and the heart by the fact of how different our culture is in the US compared to other cultures around the world. We don't appreciate rest. We almost treat rest as if it is like you should almost feel guilty if you're resting, because this mindset of hustle and grow and to be successful, I have to keep moving and I have to keep doing. And we laud being busy, right? We compare, like, I'll say, oh, I've been so busy. And you're like, oh, you think you've been busy? Let me tell you how busy I've been. We pride ourselves. I don't think we do it intentionally, but we pride ourselves on busyness. We pride ourselves on hustle. We pride ourselves on how many check marks we can get through in the day. And if we tell, if somebody says, I'm going to take a day off, or you know what, I am going to do nothing today, we have a tendency to go, lucky for you. I mean, we, or we, if somebody builds rest into their day, there is just a cultural mindset, unfortunately, in the United States that that person might be lazy or not as ambitious, that they may not have as much hustle. But if you look in other cultures, right, I think about my friends that lived in, first time I visited friends that lived in Argentina, and they were missionaries, like full on, that's what they did their whole day, day in, day out, their life was pouring into other folks. And I remember one of the first afternoons, I can't remember what it was, but it was like from 2 until 4. And they're like, okay, we're just going to be quiet. I go, why? It's the middle of the day. It's work day. What are you doing? Everything was closed. Every store was closed. Every restaurant was closed because they had rest baked in to their day. Like it was built into retail, everything. There was time to rest. And then in other countries where we, again, we hustle so hard, and you go on to other countries and the idea of relaxing, sitting around the table, having a luxurious time together just to enjoy each other's company, or the idea of, well, we don't walk anywhere, you walk everywhere. One of my friends that came from Kenya, well, it's his first time to the US, he's like, where are all the people? Because he was so used to folks meandering and strolling and seeing each other and taking long walks. And so, unfortunately, we don't have those things. So
yeah,
it's not just, sadly, it's just not baked into our culture overall. And so we have to be disruptive, but it's a good disruption. God disrupted, right? He stopped Jesus. Jesus wasn't in a hurry. He moved at the pace he needed to move. He stopped. He changed his mind. He did all kinds of things as he chose, but he also stepped away. He knew the importance of quiet. He tried to tell the disciples the importance of getting away, being quiet, being refreshed, that those things were important for the next thing that they were going to do. And so we could learn a lot in the U.S. from just from a little bit of culture shift to become a little bit like other parts of the world.
I wouldn't mind that at all. I feel like that 2 to 4, 3 to 5 block of time, like that's when I want to take a nap anyway. So why? Mm-hmm. I mean, if the whole world just took a nap, we would all probably
oh my
be
gosh.
A lot happier people, right? And
yeah,
maybe
I think, yes, I think if we all took a nap, we would just be kinder people
exactly.
as well.
Yeah, I was just recently listening to a sermon, and it was I can't remember what text it was in, but it was talking about the nation of Israel and the fact that they never took their Sabbaths and they never took that year of rest that they were supposed to take for their crops and their farming and their land. And it was that amount of time that they were actually in captivity. It was like God said, "You've robbed me of this time that was supposed to be really a benefit to you, to the people.
Yeah.
You've robbed it from me." And therefore he put them into captivity for 70 years. And so that's a really important theme throughout mm-hmm. scripture, is this need for rest. It's baked into our calendar. It's baked into our weeks. Mm-hmm. It's baked into the rhythms. We've often tried to usurp that or cut it out or, you know, soldier through it in some way. So
yeah.
When you're talking about Sabbath in the context of what we're talking about as writers, are you referring to like taking a day off? What does that mean? Is it a day for us? Is it or is it more of a mindset of rest? Or what do you think that should look like for us as Christian writers?
I am, and on Thursday when we talk, we'll talk about the different types of Sabbath and the different types of stepping away. But I think that it can be a variety of things, because Cara, only you know your life, right? And a rhythm that would work for you. So I think, could it be a day, or could it be a week? Could it be months where you have stepped away from, and we are going to talk specifically about the idea of creating content, right? That is the writing. We are creating some sort, even though we may not consider ourselves content creators, because those of us who are right, we're like, no, I'm not a content creator, I'm a writer. But mm-hmm. at the same time, if we are putting our words into the world, we are creating something that we are sharing. And so it could be one day a week that you say, you know what, I'm going purely analog this day. This is going to be an important thing. If that fits into your rhythm and your life and family and those things, it could be that one day a week you say, I'm laying it all down. I'm laying down all electronic stuff, and I want to be in quiet observation. I just want to have good conversation with people. It could be, for me, it is challenging for me to have a day that I get to step away. And so what I have learned are certain rhythms that, like mornings to me, it's very important that I have some time of quiet in the morning to settle and focus myself. And then for me also, when it comes to Sabbath or finding a sense of rest in my soul, it is also my writing, how often I write. And also not feeling like I have to write every day, that I have to, which I know flies in the face of Madeline L'Engle and all of those beautiful words, like you have to put something on paper every day, even if it's bad, put it on paper. But you know what? No, you don't. And if you're forcing yourself to write, if you're forcing yourself to try to find words, is that really a healthy thing? Are you really creating at that point? Are you just kind of spitting something out? So again, for me, I have found that my rhythms are more within the day itself. And it is for me far more about mindset and I call it a personal liturgy. It is the way I approach writing altogether. However, I took 3 months off of all social media this year. I needed to step away.
Yeah, what was that like? How did you do that?
I did not delete anything because I know some folks will delete everything, but because I also work for a nonprofit and my team manages all of social media for the nonprofit, I couldn't step away entirely. But what I chose to do was to not publish anything. I would still write, but I was feeling this sense of compulsion that I needed to put things out into the world. And I was becoming drained creatively. Writing was not a joy. It was becoming a task. And I knew that, okay, it's like, okay, I'm depleted. There's something going on with me. And I need to give writing some space that it can feel good and whole again. Because right now I'm feeling a sense of obligation instead of joy. And when I put words out, and so I know some folks will say, you don't need to let people know, you don't need to do that. But I love to pray for folks. And I'm always inviting folks to send me messages in my DMs and stuff like that to pray. So I planned my departure and did not know for sure when I was going to come back, but wrote some messages that if somebody happened to check in on me, they would be able to see that, okay, she's fine, she's good. And I let everybody know, if you still need prayer, just send me a private message. It's good. I'm still here. I just need to step away. I need some time. And I did it, and it was very, very good for me. And first of all, I mean, I just rested for like literally rested my eyes and rested my hand and rested my fingers on the keyboard, and did not obligate myself to try to write. Instead, I was like, you know what? I'm just going to read, or I'm going to listen to other people's words. But I just needed that time. And we'll talk about that again on Thursday of different ways that you can do that. Because it's also from a writing standpoint, you may not be able to completely step away from everything or to say, I'm just going to walk away from it all.
I think the point too is that it's purposeful rest, right? It's not necessarily like, I just need a break, although that may be how you frame it and that's okay. But it's about the filling, right?
Yeah.
I think often as writers, we feel like we have to be giving and we need to be like producing beautiful, eloquent, helpful content. But again, mm-hmm. the content is made up of words, right?
Yeah.
And so we feel like we need to be producers all the time. And I feel that. I think, mm-hmm. you know, and I think one way, like I was just thinking about it today, it's like, I think when we're bombarded with so-and-so just wrote a post or so-and-so just went live, so-and-so, you know, released a new newsletter, whatever it is, we start to feel this pressure of like, mm-hmm. oh, I'm not keeping up. I'm not doing enough. And so we get into that comparison trap, which is often really, really difficult. But again, it's that incessant feeling of I have to be producing all the time. And we can't be producers unless we're also consumers of grace and Jesus and time in his word and nature and fresh air. Yeah. Like, these are the things that God has created us for. And I think sometimes we just kind of cut off our inspiration at the source, don't you?
Oh, I think so. The past probably year and a half, I am not a gardener. I am not a farmer. I'm not any of those things. I have a consummate brown thumb. I have a hard time even like growing a succulent when they tell you, you never have to water it. I'm like, this could be for me. And then they die. But I have become just fascinated with the fruit of the spirit overall, thinking of the fruit of the spirit as like a legitimate fruit, and then where would love and peace and joy and all those things fit within the context of that fruit. But because of that, I've also spent a lot of time just learning about soil and like, oh, so all soil is dirt, but not all dirt is soil, because soil is alive and it has oxygen in it, has water in it, nutrients, and that's how that's how the vines will grow. And the fact that in order for a fruit, like fruit, to really bear beautiful fruit, you can't grow that fruit from seed. That fruit, you need a seedling, and then you graft it into a stable, mature tree. And so I automatically think about when Jesus, like, abide in me and I'll abide in you, and I'm the vine and you're the branch. And then all of that then leads to, okay, if our purpose here on this earth, for all the days that God gives us breath, is to bear the fruit of his very presence in our lives. And that fruit is life-giving and healing and nurturing to all of those around us. Then we also need those times when fruit doesn't grow all the time. If I try to force a tree to bear fruit all the time, the fruit will become bitter and hard and no good for anybody. And if I am trying, right? And if I'm a farmer, I can't make something grow faster. It's going to grow in its time. And so I think all of those things have also taught me, like, no, I need to be open to seasons of rest in order, if I really am going to bear any kind of fruit. And as a writer, it's like, if my words are going to have, if they're going to be quickened by the presence of God, then I probably need to remember that I'm not going to bear fruit all the time. And there are going to be times that maybe I'm even going to be pruned. Because if I'm not pruned, if there are those seasons where stuff that's not fruitful, if it's not lopped off, and I'm not willing to say, you know what, I'm going to lay that down for a little bit, because I want God, I want you to let me know if that's, do I need to pick it back up again? Or is it not bearing the right fruit for you? But if I'm not willing to allow him to refine and shape and prune me, and to, if I'm not willing to rest, then the fruit that I bear will make you sick. It will not bring life to you. And it may look good on paper, because a grapevine fully loaded with grapes may look really pretty to somebody, and those grapes may be small and bitter and of no use whatsoever, because that vine hasn't been tended to. And so that's why I also think about Sabbath not necessarily as a day, but it is finding the seasons in our days, right, that we say, I don't have to produce, I can't bear the fruit anyway, I'm just a branch, I want God to bear the fruit in me. And so I don't want to try to manufacture it to try to be cool, or to manufacture it because I'm looking at the wrong fruit. I'm looking at platform as fruit. I'm looking at followers as fruit, or subscribers as fruit, or did I get another book deal as fruit? Instead, it's like, no, man, my perspective needs to, I need to cling to the vine. I need to let the Lord whisper what it is he wants me to say, so then I'm doing the right thing, I'm bearing his fruit.
That's so many good things in that, because like you said, appearances can be deceiving, right? And we don't always, you can take an apple off a tree and you can take a bite of it and it's soft and it's mealy and it doesn't taste very good. We can produce what looks like fruit sometimes and still be like, not, I like how you said, not that the vine hasn't been tended, like our souls haven't been nurtured, or we're not allowing the gardener to nurture us because we're too busy trying to appear fruitful, yeah, when maybe we're not so much. So, okay, let's, you mentioned platform earlier, and I think that is probably what hits us most as mm-hmm. writers, and the struggle with that. And then the idea of resting. And I'm sure this applies in the business world too. You're working yeah. really hard on building a business or building a ministry or whatever. And if you feel like, I can't stop, if I stop, then everything falls apart, or mm-hmm. I lose the momentum I have, or I lose the progress, or I'll become irrelevant. People won't remember who I am, or out of sight, out of mind. Like, these are all the things that we might yeah. be struggling with as writers. That prevents us from taking Sabbath, from taking rest. So do you have wisdom to share with us in terms of how we can frame that better in our own minds as writers?
I'm still learning.
It's hard to rest. Yeah.
It is very hard to rest. And I would love to tell you that this far into my life journey and all of those that it's like, oh, I've got it nailed, and I don't get caught up in the fear and listening to that hiss that whispers in my ear and says, oh, but if you stop now, nobody will know you. Or, oh, if you, the only way for you to be meaningful in this life is to be known in this life. Or unless your words are read by millions, they don't count for anything. Mm-hmm. And and sometimes that your head knowledge and heart knowledge, right? It feels like it's a million miles away. But I know everybody has their own style. What I have learned to do with fear, and with that fear of becoming irrelevant, or the fear of not getting the book deal, or the fear of not being big, or being successful in the world's eyes, what success is, because the world views success as metrics. It is a number, right? Even in churches, we're like, biggest, fastest growing church, everything. Nobody ever says, now, you know what? That church is the deepest church I know. Mm-hmm. That church sacrifices more than any. That church purposely stayed small because they decided that they wanted to just care about their local community. Nobody brags about those folks. They want to brag bigger, better, brighter, bolder. That is, and that's the pressure we feel all the time, no matter what. We could be writers. We could own a clothing store or whatever. And there's always going to be the pressure to be the best, or to be the first on trend, or be the coolest, or whatever. And now in the age of influencers, it's even more pressure, because it can't just be that you sell something. You ought to be the first person to sell it, because you want to be the person that is trend spotting or getting ahead of everybody before everybody else is doing it. But I have learned to do, and this is in my own head, so it may not work for anybody else, but I have realized that fear is a toothless lion, and I have to remember that. Instead of allowing the voice of fear to dominate me, and I have to talk myself in the mirror and like, okay, honey, you're listening to fear again. What is fear telling you? But what do you know about fear? Fear can't spell hope. Fear is illiterate. Fear is a toothless lion. Fear is just trying to get you to cower. And instead I'm like, okay, fear, I see you. And you know what? This is what I choose to do today. I choose to do because I'm going to choose what I know is the best part of me. I'm choosing to press in and cling to Christ. I am choosing to not feel rushed. These are the things I'm choosing today. And so you could call it quiet defiance or whatever, but it is basically not allowing fear, that kind of fear, the fear that says I will be rendered inadequate or anonymous if I don't hustle, if I don't do the thing, to say no. I can step away. I can do this. Fear does not get the control of me.
And I think so often we have to name it, right? Like this is being prompted by fear.
Yeah.
And, you know, our God does not operate in those categories. He does not give us a spirit of fear, but of power yeah. and of love and of a sound mind.
Yeah.
And so I think so much of it is often just recognizing, where is this pressure coming from? Because mm-hmm. it's not from God, right? It's from the world around us and the things that we see and that we are drawn to, idols in our own hearts. But nevertheless, a difficult battle that we wage all the time. Some of the ladies on this call are just
they're blowing up the chat, which is so cool.
They have a lot to say about this because I think we all know that this is just this hits us right mm-hmm. where we live, in terms of just the struggle to rest, the struggle to trust God. And maybe that's really what it comes down to, right? It's like, mm-hmm. do we really trust God? Are we taking up our own platform, so to speak, and seeking to make a name for ourselves when maybe that's not what God has for us, or we need to steward it well, whatever the case may be.
Well, if I figured that if Eve, who literally got to walk in the cool of the afternoon with God mm-hmm. in Eden with everything she needed, still said, I don't know if he really has it all figured out.
Yeah.
That if she had that struggle, then it's not going to be a struggle that's unfamiliar to me.
Absolutely. It goes back to the garden, doesn't it?
It does.
Do we trust God? Is he enough?
Yeah. And I would love to say, I laugh a lot because I'm like, I feel like I live in the perpetual state of, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. And for me, when it comes to Sabbath and rest and laying down the pen and some of those intentional acts that are disruptive to everything that publishers tell us, everything that writing coaches tell us, all of those things, in that way, to me, that is my quiet, like, I'm going to choose to trust him, even though my boots are quaking just a little bit. And even though I know every metric might tell me otherwise, I am going to choose right now. I am not going to get caught in fear. I'm going to lay it down for a little bit because I can't hear God.
Mm-hmm.
I have so many of my own thoughts in my head. I have so many things I'm trying to write down on paper. I'm trying to figure out how to woo you on social media. Do you think that I'm going to be able to hear a calm, beautiful, reasonable voice that says, do you think you just might trust me just a little bit, that I just might know what's best for you? And I can get that whole idea of fruit again. Man, I can try to push out I can do everything I can to be fruitful. So you're impressed with my fruit because I got a whole basket of it for you, and it not do for you what the fruit of God's presence in my life is supposed to do. And that is the fruit that I should be. I think that's the fruit that I want to see God produce in my life. And I think part of it too, it's a tough thing, but it is that, would I be willing to lay down a thing I love, which I love writing. I've always been a words girl. Would I be willing to lay it down? I don't think God would ever ask me to lay it down, because I also know that he's a good God and kindly puts these desires and talents in our lives and all kinds of stuff like that. So I don't think he'd go like, never pick up a pen again. I don't hear that voice out of him. But would I be willing to lay it down if it meant that his presence would be seen in and through me a little bit more?
Well, I think about Abraham wanting a son more than anything, God promising him a son, and then God asking him, lay down your son's life. Love me more than you love your son. Love me more than you love the things, the good gifts that I give. Right. And I think that often, I agree with you. I don't think God wants to take those things away from us, but I do think that we need to love him supremely. Right. And we have to love him more than we love his gifts, more than we love the kudos and the shares and the likes and whatever the metric is. We need to love him more. And that's the pruning that produces more fruit. And that's often the painful part of this whole growth process.
I know Space just said, the more I walk with God, the more I realize my desperate need to stay dependent. And it's interesting because years ago, I wrote a whole thing about, like, I am a recovering independent, because I was raised in a bootstrapping family that you make your own way and you pull yourself up by your bootstraps and, you know, you count on yourself and you show everybody how independent you are. You don't need a man. You don't need this. You don't need anything. And I brought that fierce independence into my relationship with the Lord. And I have had to lay it down time and time again to say, Lord, you know what? My ability to be able to make good decisions, my ability to do all kinds of stuff like that, is I want it to be directly correlated to how dependent I am on you. I want to abide in you. I want to have your life truly living in and through me. And I don't want to look at you as the thing that I could be independent of. I need to learn dependence. And so I feel like all of this stuff, the idea of Sabbath, of laying something down, of taking rest, that is an act of dependence on God, because you're like, I'm letting it go. I'm going to back off. I'm not going to try to strive. I'm not going to try to work. I am going to rest and believe that God has my best interest at heart. He is going to bring refreshing and healing. He is going to talk to me in ways that he couldn't if I was just running amok. He loves, again, I'm going to go back to Eden. His delight, his favorite thing to do was to meet with Adam and Eve in the garden in the cool of the day and have a great conversation. But that requires a restful pace where you can even have a conversation with somebody. And instead, we are running and gunning. And he's like, if you would just stop.
Yeah.
You're going to see who I am, and you're going to be able to see that you can trust me. And I might just have some things to say to you that will
you just quiet down long enough to listen. Yeah.
if you just shut up. No, he would
just
never
be quiet. Absolutely.
Stop your yapping for just a second.
Be quiet.
Yeah.
Well, Ronnie, this has been such a great conversation. I've needed it in my own heart, just as I've been getting distracted again and again about, you know, why I'm doing what I'm doing. And this is a good reminder to me to to rest, not necessarily stop what I'm doing, but to rest in my spirit and to let go of my own agenda and trust God with all the things that I'm working on and striving for. So I'm so appreciative of this message. And tell us a little bit more about what you're going to talk about on Thursday.
Well, we are going to talk about rest. We are going to talk about just some practical ways that you can step away. Because, well, first of all, rest is actually an active verb, right? Rest is not nothing. There is still action that you have to do in order to rest. You have to step away. You have to maybe take a seat. You have to let go of things that you're doing. Maybe it's slowing activities down. So we're going to talk about rest, what rest means, both physically, but we're also going to talk about rest when it comes to our souls and resting our brains. And then we're going to talk about some practical ways that you can rest from writing. Because there are some very practical ways to be able to take a step back from writing. When I'm talking about writing, I'm talking about public writing. Please understand, because I believe that there is a beautiful place for you to let that pen just write what's going on in your gut. And there are times that writing, I know for me, writing can be therapeutic, especially I call it slow journaling because I use my computer. Here it is right here. And it's so easy for me on a computer just to blast out things. And so I journal with a pen and paper, and I call it slow journaling because my hand cannot move as fast as my brain. So it forces my brain to slow down.
I love that.
Which is also, it is a therapy. It's a form of rest for me, is that because it initially frustrated the snot out of me. It's like, you've got to be kidding. I can't just sit here. And then it's like, no, wait. And I find that when I slow down, there are times if I slow down, I might think about something in a different way than I've ever thought about it before. If I slow down, I may start thinking a little bit more about that soil being alive and what that living soil might mean for me, or what a season of rest might be, or I'll think about, oh, you know what? They burn the fields in Guatemala as part of rotation. Burn them. Would I, you know, Lord, what might that mean in my life? Are there things that nothing but fire? It's only the fire that's actually going to create. Because in Guatemala, they burn the fields and that singed soil, new minerals form in that soil so that soil can grow new things. It gives that soil a chance to be reborn. Like, man, are there things that I am too afraid to say, yeah, if that burns, I'm okay with that. Because maybe God has a rebirth in an area in my life. So, but that's what slow journaling does for me. It helps me, or stepping away, or getting out in nature and just taking a walk and realizing that the same God that we're so blasted fortunate in the United States, but we got 500 plus translations of scripture, but God is, you know, he reveals himself in nature that then points back to scripture. And I love that. He reveals himself in science. And you're like, oh my gosh, so cool. Well, those things, if I was so busy writing all the time, trying to produce content, I don't know if I would see those things, which then will fuel an opportunity for me to share something different or maybe something more meaningful. I'm sorry, people are walking by because I'm at work.
Oh, I've had the distractions going on around me too.
I know. Now I'm like, oh my gosh, now I'm distracted. What were we talking about? On Thursday, we are also going to talk about, I'm going to share some things that I have learned to build some breathing room into the when I do put words that I want to put, I think that I want to put into the world, how even breathing room is now built into that
that sounds great.
Area of my life. And then finally, we're going to talk about basic tips and tricks for you to be able to Sabbath, step away. And this is the literal stepping away from social platforms and stuff without anybody having even knowing. Because if you're like, I want to do it, but yet I know that I need to be, I've got my writing course out there. I've got things out there that still, my business still needs to be, I need to share. There are things that you can do. There are things, basic, fundamental things that you can do that will allow you breathing room. And so we're going to talk about that. They are not rocket science, but they are tools that actually work. And so, and I'm saying that they work because I've tested them out and they work.
So and she's still here and she's still writing, everybody. Yeah. So, well, this has been so great. We have a few minutes left. I know there've been some comments. I invite you to turn on your camera, make any comments or ask any questions if you have them of Ronne. We've had a lot of talk in the chat. For those who are watching the replay might not see that, but I think this is an issue that writers and maybe just people deal with, right? Of learning how to Sabbath. So
yeah, I actually did a women's retreat 2 weekends ago, and the theme was rest oration. And, you know, we capitalized REST, and you know, I talked about it really isn't a four-letter word. And that it's yeah. It's not just a suggestion, but it's a command from the Lord.
Yeah.
And throughout scripture we see that, and he set the example for us in, like you said, Kara said 1/7 of creation, but it is a he didn't have to rest. He doesn't sleep or slumber.
Yeah.
But it was something that he did to be able to sit back and look at what he had done and say, this is good. And I think that needs to be part of our writing routine. And you know, like Space and I were talking this morning during our prayer time, and she's reading her book out loud to herself out in the woods and recording it and listening. And she's actually really enjoying it. And I think that's part of the restorative process is to go, oh man, you know, I know that, yeah, rest isn't just for when we get to a point where we've worked so hard that we're beat into the ground. We should actually take the rest before we get to that point.
Yeah.
But it is good to be able to sit back and see the work that we've done and go, thank you, Lord, for using me to do that, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, thank you, Lord, for giving me those words to speak or write or whatever it is.
I'm glad that you brought that up about reading your own words, and yay, you, Space, for reading your own words to yourself. I think so often we need to go back. We need to read past journal entries. We need to see what we posted 5 years ago. We need to see that, because if we really believe that God's presence is moving in and through us and we are ministers of his good news, then there's a high likelihood that the stuff that we wrote, right, inspired by God, that the stuff that we wrote back then might actually be able to teach us something now. And it's one of my little tips and tricks that I share with folks of when you're in that spell and you need to rest, one of the beautiful things that you honestly can do if you are wanting to rest but still wanting to share things is pull from your own annals, if you will. Amy, love you. Thank you so much. Is to pull from writings that you've had in the past, because there is so often that that will speak to, especially if it's been on social media, that stuff is gone. It has been pushed way down a feed. Nobody is going to dig up something unless you're like, you know what? It's still meaningful today. Those words are still important today. In fact, the words that I shared 3 years ago, oh my gosh, had I only known what I know now. And so now those words are even more rich. And there's another piece of the story to add, because God is this beautiful additive God, right? He doesn't waste things. He adds to the story and builds upon the story. So that's one of my tips and tricks.
Sneak peek, everybody. So,
it's an important thing, but space to read your own words. That is so beautiful. And there are times that I will read words back that I've written long ago, and I just start bawling because I'm like, oh my gosh, yes. God, that was clearly you speaking. And yes. you may have been speaking to somebody else back then, but right now, man, these words are slaying me. Yeah.
I've had that same experience. Even things that I wrote, 12, 13 years ago. But I had a funny experience. I spoke at that retreat as well as coordinating it. And yes, that is a little bit of lunacy, but anyway, the Lord saw fit to give me a huge challenge right before the retreat. I thought, okay, I'm going to have this day of rest before the retreat. I'm going to go get a pedicure. I'm going to sit in the sunshine. I'm going to take a deep breath. And I'm sitting on my porch swing, drinking my coffee and praying with my husband. And my mom called and told me she'd swallowed her dentures. And let's just say it was, I'm like, I couldn't even process it. I said, okay, give me a couple minutes to figure out what I need to do. And I had to go pick her up and take her to the emergency room. And I spent the next 2.5 days at the emergency room with her. And this is the 2.5 days before the biggest event all year that I do. And, but it was the Lord forcing me to rest because I had to just sit there with her for 2.5 days. But the funny thing is, and he worked a miracle in that whole situation, but as we were sitting there waiting, I put one of my earbuds in her ear and the other one in my ear. And we were listening to my message. So my mom got to hear my message and aww. I got to hear and correct it. And it was really sweet, except for then, as I'm getting worked up about, all of the things that we have to do while we're there in the hospital, it was really a very, very unpleasant experience, but it was anyway, I don't need to go into the gross details of all of it, but there was some big frustrations, and she goes, it sounds like somebody needs to take a little dose of their own medicine. sometimes we write and we speak the words that we need to hear the most, and sometimes by going back and listening to them again, we're reminded of the work that the Lord's doing in our lives and how we need to really just stop and appreciate the truth that he speaks into our lives all the time and how he's given us the ability to share it with others. And he will force rest on us if we don't do it.
Yes, he will. But that's the thing is, right? Because that's when you're going, okay, Lord, I want good fruit in my life. And that fruit is evident over time because you're like, oh, wait, that fruit lasted. The healing attributes of that story or whatever, it's life-giving. It's transformative. That's thank you, Lord, because that is the fruit I want. And that's not fruit I get to manufacture. I can't make that fruit up. That comes from abiding in your presence. And then time will show that fruit was the good stuff. So I have people peeking in my office door now. You can tell I've got a meeting and they're all like, can we come in? Can we come in?
Well, we want to respect your time, Ronnie, and we are closing out the hour. So thank you so much. Thank you for being here, reminding us of this truth. Thank you, Space, for being here and making the effort to be here. She mentioned that it took some some shuffling to be here. So we appreciate you doing that. And Carrie, for your story. Mm-hmm. Ronnie, for your wisdom. Thank you so much. And we'll see you all here again, Lord willing, on Thursday.
Yes. Can't wait. All right.
Bye-bye. Thanks, okay. Everybody.
Bye.